is a very important figure, leader inside the Black is Back Coalition. His brother is the senior editor of the Black Agenda Report, who will discuss the role of money in political campaigns. Glen Ford is a political columnist known for his astute observations and exhaustive research. Ford's presentation is expected to provide an uncensored and factual account of the long-term policy-making impact of the corporate financing of political candidates. A consistent critic of the Obama regime, Ford has published numerous articles on the financial interests that Obama's policies and initiatives benefit. So at this time, I would like to introduce to everybody Glen Ford. Uhuru.
Power to the people. Now, I promise I'm only going to mention Obama's name maybe once or twice, because we at Black Agenda Report are Obama'd out. But mostly because we understand that this subject of Black electoral participation is much bigger than Obama. And because there have been vast changes that affect the efficacy, the usefulness of Black electoral activity in the past 40 years, and especially in the last 10 years. So I want to take a kind of historical overview in examining the role that the bourgeois control over the electoral process plays, not in general, like I think we're familiar with the general outlines, but how that affects Black electoral politics, the candidates that get thrown up in our name and that we wind up having to choose between. The rulers of the United States have always been property owners, and I'd like to remind folks that the first presidential election in the United States was participated in at that level by only 10,000 people out of a total population of 2.5 million, a half a million of whom were Africans. Now these rulers are situated mainly on Wall Street. They have always directed dissent into the electoral process because it is a rigged game and it never directly threatens their rule. But much of the Black struggle has been a fight to get in the game. And we've talked about this many times at Black is Back conferences, that there are basically two main currents of Black thought. And these two currents coexist often in the same Black brain. They coexist, but there is a push and pull and a conflict and a tension. And those two currents are, one, what I call the representationist current. And that representationist, you gotta represent, actually wants nothing more than to see Black faces in high places, Black faces supposedly representing us in politics and in the economy and in the national culture. But this tendency does not give a damn about transforming society as long as Black faces are included in whatever goes on. The second current is self-determinationism, and that's us, everybody in this room. It's about building institutions and movements and consciousness in ways that express and that serve the African American community, and that also means serving humanity, because African American interests and African interests are humanity's interests. Electoral politics has at various times, and this has been throughout our history, seemed to fit the bill for both currents at different times. Certainly the representationalists and often the self-determinationists. We know that Malcolm grew to think that elections had some utility for Black folks in his last days on earth, that voting could be of some use to us in the struggle for self-determination, which of course is what Malcolm was about. This subject was one that was gone over many times back in the old days when I was young. And many here remember those discussions. They were quite heated and vital and probably our most stimulating intellectual era was when we were discussing what are we going to do with this potential electoral power. And so today we're kind of revisiting a subject that actually has been neglected over the past 40 years. And I'm so glad that the Black Is Back Coalition is going to revisit this. Many black revolutionaries back in the day saw that we would have to, and soon, face the challenge, what to do with the black metropolis. Because in the 60s, it was becoming clear that this new demographic was going to change some very basic things about black life. But the cities were rapidly, in such a very few years, becoming black, that the national profile would be something that we couldn't have imagined in the 50s, that we would be the majority in so many of the nation's biggest cities and have a dominant, say, a very active plurality in most of the others. This new demographic phenomenon was a lot bigger than what we used to call community. When we said the black community, we really used to mean a neighborhood. And we were not talking about the city and what are we gonna do with the city, since we now are, population-wise, the city. So it was a very different kind of meaning. And we did talk about it, but events were moving very quickly back in those days, and COINTELPRO and those other repressions by the state were causing deep disruptions on the black left and among folks who considered themselves to be nationalist. And those disruptions, which is a euphemism for murder, interrupted that conversation that we had started to have in the mid and going into the late 60s about how to build a black city, what to do when we're a majority. The question would have involved all of the functions of civil society. By definition, if you are the majority in the city and you're talking about electing your representatives to run the city, then you have to talk about all the functions of the city. You have to talk about education and neighborhood security and economic development, the whole bit. This is a huge conversation that we had not had reason to talk about before in our day-to-day struggles because we didn't control the city. But here, this looming future was looking right at us. We did begin to have this conversation, but it was interrupted and disrupted by the state, by COINTELPRO and such. So while the U.S. security apparatus had us, and I'm talking about those on the left and nationalists, in a state of disarray, the representationalists and the opportunists who wanted nothing more than to get into the game rushed into the electoral arena. And they quickly declared that elections were the only way to go and that mass grassroots politics was passé, that the time had come and gone for that kind of stuff. And it was time to stop that. And there was a more sophisticated approach to politics, and it was voting. They basically were telling us that there was nothing worth turning out for in terms of masses of people except to vote for a black politician. And by the way, that's me. So what did those black politicians do when they achieved the mayor's office? The first thing that Maynard Jackson did in Atlanta was proclaim that his overall goal, his ambition as mayor, was to create a local class of millionaires. And he just said it straight up. Then, and this is his first action, he broke the strike of the mostly black sanitation workers in Atlanta. The same people that Dr. Martin Luther King had died attempting to defend only a few years earlier. Maynard Jackson set the tone for many of our worst black mayors. Now, it's got to be said that not every black mayor was as blatant a bourgeois operative as Maynard Jackson was. But the general behavior of black mayors in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s and going into today was in effect quite similar. They did not have a plan on how to build a black city. I don't think they even thought in those terms. Most of them came to see their job as begging capital, as begging the money folks to come back to the cities. And to them, that meant white people coming back. So they enter office wanting the white folks and their money to come back. No sooner, that is, had black folks achieved the demographic feat of becoming majorities and dominant pluralities in so many cities when their elected representatives began trying to figure out how to bring the white folks back. Most of those black politicians didn't put it that way. They spoke in what I'd call general nationalist terms, and people accepted the rhetoric, but their actions were as beggars. Please come back and help us. Don't abandon us like this. Please come back with your money and we'll set a place for you. These politicians methodically traded the unused and vacated parts of the city to corporations. They did that as incentives for the corporations to come back. We'll give you the world if you just bless us with your presence once again. They knew, and any fool should have known, that most corporations demand that there be enclaves for their upscale white workers and all the rest of their business operations. And that is part of any investment deal. They don't just give you the money and say, you know, we're not going to take a part of this city for our basically exclusive use. Some black mayors were shamelessly down with the whitening process in the cities. Washington, D.C.'s mayor, Anthony Williams, and he was mayor from 99 to 2007, he announced that D.C., which was the quintessential chocolate city, could easily accommodate 200,000 new residents. And everybody knew that he was not talking about new black people. Atlanta became the first major city to totally demolish public housing, which was, of course, 100% black in Atlanta. But other black-run jurisdictions were not far behind Atlanta. And so we witnessed what I think is the ultimate irony. The same class of black opportunists who had risen to local power through the blackening of America's cities presided over the demographic reversal of fortunes later on. They presided over the whitening of those same cities, and they did it by design. These were the collaborators in the methodical dismantling of black majorities and black electoral power in the cities, a process that is ongoing but by now inexorable. We can't stop that one. We're too far behind in the curve. The same people who told us that the only path to progress was through harnessing our demographic power. That is, they said it is through the strength of our numbers that we will be able to come to power and effectuate change. These same people, this same class of politician, were complicit in the erasing of that singular advantage that we had accrued. And now that demographic window is closing. We have allowed our chance to build the black metropolis to be squandered by the same class, and it is the very same people who abandoned the mass movement at their first opportunity back in the late 60s. That is a sin of historic proportions, and we should never, ever forget and never, ever forgive them for having squandered that historical opportunity. We collectively cut them all that slack and all that time, and they left us nothing from that now quickly bygone age of the black city. They are bankrupt in the eyes of history. Now I'm going to be a little bit more direct at addressing the subject of money and electoral politics. I think that's another way of saying bourgeois monopoly of the electoral process. There are lots of places to go on the internet where you can find out that the two corporate political parties in 2008, the last presidential cycle, spent $2 billion on that that dance. We know that Barack Obama spent, and this is just the official tally, more than $700 billion, and that McCain, and that McCain spent roughly half of that. But this is a conference of the Black is Back Coalition, and so we want to talk about, I want to talk about how all that election money, and not the 2008 money, but the whole process affects our polity, the black polity, how it affects the black political conversation. So I'm not going to make a kind of general critique. It is true that for more than two decades, our black misleadership class mayors have been selling us out. It's true that they have been eroding our demographic base, and it's true that they've been kissing the butts of every corporation that ever showed any interest in all, at all in coming back to the cities. But during the first few decades after the civil rights and black power movements, corporate America itself had not made any concerted effort to cultivate their own branded black political class in the country. They had not raised up a new crop of folks who knew all the buzzwords and were very consciously working towards a consolidation of corporate control in America. They gave us two decades in that sense of a respite. They were going around the country subverting and suborning and laying out all kinds of astroturf money with all kinds of other groups. They were subverting labor by setting up anti-labor groups that claimed to be labor groups. And they were subverting environmentalists by setting up actually corporate front organizations that claimed that they were environmentalists, and on and on and on. But they didn't do too much of that with us. And the reason, I believe, is that these guys were so racist, they didn't want too many black folks in the room in the cocktail party. They couldn't conceive of that kind of intimate relationship that you actually really do have to cultivate with these people who you're going to put out there as fronts for you. And they were just too racist to do that for a very long time. And they gave us a kind of breathing room. We didn't do much with it, but we were not subjected to the full force of their money politics for more than two decades. And that's until the mid-90s. In the mid-90s, an outfit called the Bradley Foundation, which George Bush calls his favorite foundation, and they have a bunch of satellite think tanks, and they decided that the ideal wedge that they could conjure up with their money between blacks and unions, and remember those are the twin pillars of the Democratic Party, they're supposed to be the twin pillars of the progressive movement, but we don't have any progressive movement. But the Democratic Party was enough. And so they realized that because black folks revere or say that we revere education so much, this was the place to go to put a wedge between blacks and especially the teachers union. And it turned out to be a master stroke. They then decided to use their money with us the way they had used it with so many other groups. They decided to fund these an AstroTurf organization to bring together a bipartisan pack of Republican and Democratic opportunists to toe the corporate line on school vouchers for private schools and later on for charter schools. And they found their young black champion in this search for a wedge. And his name was Cory Booker. And he was a first-term councilman here in Newark, New Jersey. They also found a whole bunch of other black prostitutes, but Cory was the shining star. And who are they? They are this same menagerie of old money billionaires, plus now the new high-tech billionaires like Mark Zuckerman and, of course, Bill Gates. And their project, and it was planned thoroughly at the Bradley Foundation and at their funded think tanks, their project was to transform black politics right down to the precinct level in the inner city. And they, knowing that Newark was the quintessential chocolate city and was a not too big a morsel to chew, not as large as D.C. or Philadelphia or certainly Detroit, something manageable, they decided, and they had their star here, they decided to target Newark. Their initial thrust, and it's still a major thrust of those, is for the privatization of public education. But their larger goal, and this was always the strategic goal, was to raise up a whole new cohort of black corporate politicians. They have largely succeeded. All of those shining stars that they talk about so glowingly in the corporate media, you know their names, but and I promise not to mention our president's name too often. But they all come from that new class, and I mean that like the class of Harvard. This is the new class, graduated and assiduously cultivated and plied with money by these folks who would transform black politics. 2002 was their big offensive. This is when they kicked off this experiment. Most of us, of course, didn't know at the time that we were being attacked. That offensive started right here in Newark. It was Cory Booker's first run for mayor, and that was the starting gun. Mayor Sharp James, he didn't know what he was up against. He didn't realize that this was going to be a different kind of race, a different kind of race than anyone had experienced, because this was a new initiative from the folks who rule. Now, let me say up front that Sharp James was corrupt. Let me then say that corrupt is nothing new in black politics, and he was not uniquely corrupt, he's just corrupt. Sharp James also wanted to sell the city's water supply to a private company and anything else that he could have detached. There's nothing strange about that. He was quite ready to sell out in that he resembled so many black mayors. But he was not a conscious soldier for capital or for capitalism. He was just corrupt. Cory Booker was another thing entirely. He was the real deal. He was their first graduate, sigma cum laude, however y'all say that. And this was their first deep down in the ghetto foray into black politics. As I said, down to the precinct level, the place you got to go if you're going to elect a corporate guy as the mayor of Chocolate City. Booker was a political nobody at that time. I'm talking about 2002. But he officially, according to the books, spent $2.8 million in that 2002 race versus Mayor Sharp James's $2.3 million. Now, this is amazing. Sharp James had been mayor for 16 years. He was universally considered to be the most powerful black politician in New Jersey. I remember the Star Ledger published a list of, I think it was 10 of them, 10 people that they called the barons that ran Newark and Northern New Jersey. And all but one of those barons, according to the Star Ledger, all but one of them were fantastically rich businessmen. The one, that baron that was not, was Sharp James. So Sharp James had access to money. Sharp James had been used to getting businesses to give to his campaign, but nothing like Cory Booker. Sharp James told me that he thought Cory Booker had raised $10 million. And I don't think that that's quite true, but it looked like $10 million because Cory Booker in his campaign got the endorsement immediately. And I don't mean just a mention on an editorial page. Got the active endorsement and active laudatory coverage from every corporate media outlet in the New York metropolitan area. And we're talking about people who would not give a damn about Newark since the riots in 67, or at least since the election of the first black mayor. But all of them were there rooting for Cory, and that was worth millions of dollars. We, and I say that because I was a part of those who were trying to beat Cory, we did beat him, 53-47%, that was only 3,000 votes. We said that he was working for the rich white man, and that seemed to work. But the right wing, the people that were backing him, they were actually quite happy. Remember, this was an experiment, and he had almost won. So that was quite encouraging for them. And then 2 months later, the election was in April of 2002. 2 months later, it was Earl Hilliard's, Congressman Earl Hilliard's turn in the Black Belt of Alabama. Hilliard was also running against nobody. That nobody's name was Archer Davis. He was just an assistant prosecutor in Birmingham. But here comes another tidal wave of money, new people in town, money that nobody had ever seen. Hilliard didn't know what hit him, just like Sharp James didn't know. Archer Davis spent $1.5 million, and this is Alabama money, $1.5 million on a congressional seat. Earl Hilliard, the incumbent, spent less than half of that, and of course, he lost. And then a couple of months later, in August, the big money crashed down on Cynthia McKinney's head in Atlanta. She was vastly overspent by another nobody, a former Republican named Denise Majette. The corporate media not only jumped in with all 4 feet like they had in the Sharp James race, but they made this a national contest. They told everybody, they sent their correspondents right down to Atlanta, and they told everybody that this was a battle between the old civil rights rhetoric of politicians used up, the spent force, and the new business-friendly black politician, the new breed. And that's how they framed that race. Majette vastly overspent Cynthia McKinney, and she lost. Bruce Dixon and I, at that time at Black Commentator, we did a study, and we concluded that Cynthia McKinney had won more than 80% of the black vote. A couple of months later, a white political scientist who was constantly quoted by the Atlanta Constitution did his own study, and he said that Cynthia won 86% of the black vote while losing the election as a whole. So Cynthia McKinney won the black election. Cynthia McKinney proved the opposite of what they had concluded, proved that a black politician who identified with the tone and substance of this civil rights kind of politics actually carried overwhelmingly the black constituency of the second most affluent black majority county in the United States, second only to Prince George's County outside DC. So we have to think about, and I'll get back to this, we have to think about what is the nature of our defeat and what's the nature of our victory. How can we say that Cynthia McKinney was defeated? Not from a black viewpoint, she wasn't defeated. In black terms, she was overwhelmingly affirmed in her political stance. But her district was only about 52% black and white folks turned out in great numbers. With the totality, the total effect of this 2002 series of elections, this appearance of money, was to send a chill into the entire Congressional Black Caucus. They had never seen anything like this. Here are these two nobodies knocking off two of their colleagues in succession, overspending them tremendously. And this guy, Cory Booker, almost becoming a mayor of Newark from a position of nobodies. And Majette and Arthur Davis joined Harold Ford Jr. in a kind of conservative right-wing block in the Congressional Black Caucus. That had never existed before. Never, never, but money brought that in. And so with this right-wing block and with this threat to every incumbent, that a race which used to cost you $150,000 or $200,000 to hold on to, which is why Congressional Black Caucus members tend to be older than the rest of the House. They stay in there longer. Now, some nobody can jump up and spend $1.5 million or $1.2 million and knock you out. And that put the fear, not of God, but of money in the Congressional Black Caucus. When we look at who gave money to Arthur Davis, what do we see? Remember, this guy is nobody, and from a backwater district in the Black Belt of Alabama. Citigroup, Goldman Sachs, Bear Stearns, the American Bankers Association. Who gave money to Hilliard? The unions. And that's the case with all of the Congressional Black Caucus. And if you add up the union money, you can get $150,000. In fact, you think of that as an entitlement. And that would have been enough to get you by, but no longer. So this threat from corporate America changed the behavior of the Congressional Black Caucus. And by 2005, the caucus had been totally cowed by the threat of being unseated by corporate money, by a black candidate backed by corporate money. So we're not talking about black-white situations. We're saying that these people had successfully infested our election races. What did the caucus do when it became cowed by corporate money? They became more corporate. And so by 2005, the Black Caucus was more in favor of a bill that would have changed the way cable operates in the favor of the telecom corporations, more in favor of that bill than the House Democratic Caucus as a whole. Bobby Rush used to be high official in the Black Panther Party. He got $1 million computer center for his district from AT&T, and that made him lead the charge for the telecoms interests. This is what we've come to, and in such a short period of time, remember, this is 2005, and the starting gun for their offensive was only 2002, and yet we have a totally changed Congressional Black Caucus. Another major change, and I've run out of time, but I already have an agreement with Nellie that I can steal maybe 5 of her minutes. Thanks. I was just affirming our previous agreement. Thank you. We used to have something called supermajority congressional districts, and 60, sometimes up to 70% black, and we liked that, and all the black politicians wanted their district to be super majority. The Democrats didn't like it. The Republicans liked it, too. But the Democrats didn't like it because they felt it was in their interest to cut up the black vote, which is a guaranteed Democratic vote, among as many districts as possible. So their ideal would be to have like 20% black votes in four different congressional jurisdictions. And that way, they'd only have to win maybe 40% of the white vote, and that guaranteed 20% of the black vote would give them the district. Of course, it wouldn't give us any voice at all, but it would give Democrats the district. And so they, over a period of time, prevailed. And we don't have any more supermajority districts, and most of our districts are in the low 50s. So here we have this additional change that not only are our candidates cowed by money and running after it, but they're speaking to an audience that is barely half black, and that's by design, and that's a Democratic Party concoction. Then the question, of course, becomes, what are we going to do about this changed environment? Our urban majorities are quickly becoming a thing of the past. Big money has entered our local political races bigger than ever before, decisively, in a decisive way. And corporate media has declared, after all these changes have been imposed on us, that the old black politics is dead. The system is thoroughly rigged to discredit movement politics. And it now claims that movement-type politics, and you know what they mean by that, people like yourselves, that movement politics are actually unpopular among black people themselves. I think that we need to think back to Cynthia McKinney's so-called defeat, but which I think was a great victory in Atlanta back in 2002. When the fact that she won 86% of the black vote was pointed out, not by us, but by a white guy, the white political scientist, and then quoted in the Atlanta Constitution, that thoroughly discredited Denise Majette in the black community. Black folks didn't even realize this, but they read the Atlanta Journal. They don't necessarily read black commentator. And Denise Majette quickly passed from the scene. She never recovered from that, from being exposed as not being the voice of black DeKalb County, but in fact being the white voice with only a rump black following. At a minimum, that shows us that in terms of our entrance into electoral politics, we do have the power to discredit the corporate chosen black politician. We may not win in these rigged circumstances, but we can say, you don't represent us. I don't care if you're in there, you see. And that is a worthwhile thing to do, to delegitimize the folks that they pay to represent them in our community. Brother Charles Barron, y'all know him, and he should be here this this weekend. Brother Charles Barron won 28% of the vote in a Brooklyn congressional district against Hakeem Jeffries. The district was 56% black. Hakeem Jeffries spent $1.2 million. Brother Barron didn't spend enough to appear on the Open Secrets. He couldn't research it, so it was not a great deal of money. I think it was about $50,000, which came out to a zero. But he won 28% in a 56% black district. And if you know anything about Charles Barron, he didn't get any white votes. Negligible, not statistically worth mentioning. So simple arithmetic would tend to say that it looks like Brother Charles Barron got half of the black vote, 28-56. Sounds like exactly half of the black vote. So if for no other reason, and there are plenty of other reasons, we can say that Charles Barron succeeded in showing that Hakeem Jeffries is not the unchallenged black voice in that district. He only won half of the black vote. Half of the black vote he did not win. And that makes Charles Barron's race worthwhile. If we're going to play this electoral game, and we will, let's play it. I think we should play it by our rules. We are about black self-determination. We want allies in our struggle, and we want everybody to have self-determination. But what is most important to Black is Back is that the black worldview be expressed and heard most especially by black people themselves. To the extent that elections can serve that purpose, then they are useful to us. But we're not in this game just to play. We're in it for black power, and we're in it for social transformation. Power to the people.
Another brilliant presentation from comrade brother Glen Ford. Glen puts the black agenda in Black Agenda Report, y'all. Really laying out a really important analysis of the modern day form of neo-colonial politicians and politics in this country. So following up, the next speaker brings a similar type of analysis and wealth of information to this discussion and to the coalition. Sister Comrade Nellie Bailey will share lessons from electoral politics in New York. As co-convener of Occupy Harlem, leader of the Harlem Tenants Council, and veteran community organizer, Bailey has engaged in fierce battles with New York City politicians and officials to win human rights and improve living conditions for the black community. Through radio broadcasts, forums, and blogs, she exposes the backroom deals and financial interests at work in the political interest. So once again, I want to welcome Comrade Nellie Bailey. Yuhuru.
Thank you, everybody. It's a little hard going after Glen, but I'll do my best. But I want to pick up on Glen's narrative and talk about Harlem and electoral politics, because it is part of that same narrative that he just presented to you. And in this instance, it's a bit of a digression, because what we're going to talk about is the chicken coming home to roost for Harlem black politicians, because that's what's happening there. Unlike Maynard Jackson in Atlanta, who wanted to create a class of millionaires in Harlem, they were just fighting for the crumbs off the table for themselves and really sold out a historic black community. The People's Republic is not in Harlem, it's in Brooklyn. So I'm going to talk about the consolidation of corporate power and the final stages of Harlem's gentrification, electoral politics in Harlem's black managerial class, the chickens coming home to roost for the black politicians in Harlem. This is the new political reality, and Glen talked about it. You got one man, one woman vote, right? And then you got $1 million. And it's the money that is being fed into these local elections that are now making huge differences. And it doesn't matter where the race is, congressional races, local, state legislature races, the money is there. Congressman Charles Rangel, and I want to tell you this is my narrative about Harlem. Congressman Charles Rangel, as we all know, narrowly beat back a primary challenge for his 13th congressional seat. The money boys of the right-wing Republican Party took aim at Rangel, who milked the attack against him for all it was worth, better than to face the ugly reality of his total sellout of his constituents in the community of Harlem. It was the classic boogeyman scare, the right-wing Tea Party going after a righteous Democrat. Rangel, who has been in office for 41 years, faced a challenge from State Senator Adriana Espaillat, who, like Rangel, is in the pockets of New York City's powerful real estate industry. Espaillat received major contributions from the Super PAC campaign for primary accountability, pulled together by a pack of conservative Texas businessmen and financiers. Espaillat, who was born in the Dominican Republic and elected to the state senate 14 years ago, claimed he had no knowledge of who the donors were behind the Super PAC. The 13th congressional district was first held by Adam Clayton Powell Jr., who was elected in 1945. And the now 81-year-old Charles Rangel, who defeated Powell in 1970. Now, the I want to say here, the demographic changes that have taken place that I'm going to talk about later has altered the makeup of the 13th congressional district that is no longer a majority black district, largely through forced displacement of blacks entirely, almost entirely, due to gentrification. Under new boundaries imposed by a federal court as part of the reapportionment process every 10 years based on the census data, the 13th congressional district has been extended into the Bronx, and more than half of its population now is Latino, Dominicans. It is not likely that another black will win the seat when Rangel Lee's office, just as African Americans have pushed for the black first, so are the Dominicans who are now pushing for the first Dominican-born congressman. There is another political reality for Harlem's black managerial class. What little influence and power the black politicians had imagined they had has now ebbed away. Forced black migration out of the city has diluted black electoral power in central Harlem, the center of black Harlem. Harlem's black political establishment didn't have enough political muscle in the New York State Legislature to create a seat centered in Harlem and extend it to encompass neighborhoods, black neighborhoods, and in Westchester County and the Bronx, which had significant black populations. Then there were behind the scene hands of Governor Andrew Cuomo, who wanted a local resolution to the dispute. After all, the governor has his eyes on the White House. Obama's man in Harlem and beyond, the Right Reverend Al Sharpton, Al Charlatan as he is called by some, but I won't be nasty here, a rehabilitated figure of national respectability, convened a meeting of the bickering factions. According to a story in the New York Times, Sharpton, who wanted to protect, in his words, a predominantly black district concentrated in central Harlem, which, by the way, is the seat of his own political power, arranged a sit-down of the warring factions at the Grand Havana Room, a member-only cigar club in a luxury high-rise in Midtown Manhattan. After 3 hours of a harangue, of haranguing these imaginations of their disputes, a deal was reached. Two congressional seats that would each include Manhattan north of 110th, which begins 116th, which is really Harlem's border, but also 110th. Its southern borders was agreed upon to satisfy concerns of Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz. All of these politics, many layers here, who confronted Adriana Espaillat for advocating a new congressional district that had a Dominican majority and one without a broader Latino population. The Times article reported Espaillat dug in his heels, insisting that he wanted what was due to the Dominicans. So they reached a deal, but the New York State Legislature, of which blacks have little or no clout, nor do the Latinos, didn't approve of the deal. And so the federal court, a federal judge, stepped in, and she drew the new district lines. And so the new district line now includes Harlem, Washington Heights, and a small part of the Bronx. The new district is about 55% Latino and 27% black, although the district population of eligible voters is about 45% Latino and 34% Black. Rangel, again, in all likelihood, may very well be the last Black to hold the historic 13th congressional seat, Black as it has been for the past 45 years. Now, Central Harlem, which is Black Harlem, added 10,000 new residents in 10 years since 2003, a 9% increase in the population. Now, these are 10,000 new residents, 9,000 more whites, a 400% increase. Hispanic increased by 8,000, a 40% jump, while Blacks remained the majority with 60%. They lost 9,500 residents that produced an 11% decline. Now that's the New Harlem. And that it is, in fact, as Glen pointed out, a microcosm of what is happening across the country. Now let's go back to the People's Republic of Brooklyn, because if you were in New York City, you followed the Hakeem Jeffries and the Charles Barron race with bated breath and just your eyes on the news and on the television news media and on the print media. And part of it was because the propaganda and the attack against Charles Barron surpassed anything that anyone has witnessed in the past 20 or more years in Harlem. It surpassed everything. It was a no-hold-bar attack against Charles Barron. And he, of course, I understand, will be here later, and he will talk about this. The propaganda and the attack were so dirty and so beyond the pale, they even put out a rumor that Charles Barron's campaign had been funded or donations received from the KKK. It was unbelievable. And because Barron maintained his position and did not bulge or did not back away from those positions and his policies over the years, including support for the rights of Palestinians, and you can imagine how that doesn't go down well in New York City, as it is throughout the country. Even Chris Hedges talked about how he had to leave the New York Times when he talked about the rights of the Palestinians and how he was blacklisted. So you can imagine what it was like for Charles Barron. And of course, Hakeem Jeffries fits the mold, the cookie cutter image of what Glen just talked about, our man in New Jersey. You know, there's a prototype, there's a look that they're looking for. You can't be too black because, I mean, you know, you gotta, as it was pointed out by Barack Obama's mentors, you know, he's, you know, clean cut, you know, not too dark, you know, you don't wanna scare white people, you know. You know, we can deal with that. Hakeem is clean cut, you know, right color. You know, he can pass that paper bag test. That brown bag test, he can do all of that, you know. But most importantly, he can pass that Obama rhetoric test of the promise of change, which means absolutely nothing, because his allegiance, his alliance with is with that of the 1%, and that is Wall Street. Now, I want to talk about a couple of other things, just in terms of what else is happening in Harlem, just to give you a clue about this mop-up stage, the final stage, stages of gentrification that is taking place in this once historic black community. In a recent headline story in the Amsterdam News, Herb Boyd, that many of you know, who's a journalist and a writer, had a front page story. Black-owned Harlem suffers another blow. And it his piece chronicled a list of black-owned businesses in Harlem that have closed over the past several months. Why? Because corporate America and the banks has a death grip on Harlem that will produce an even greater forced migration out of Harlem. Now, some of you may know about the black-owned Hugh Mann bookstore that had a national reputation as the largest black bookstore in Harlem, black-owned bookstore, not only in Harlem, but in the country. But it closed after 10 years in business because of a hefty increase in its commercial rent. In fact, the increase was raised up to $10,000 a month. That's right. I didn't say 1,000, but $10,000 a month. Okay, I thought I had more time. Sorry, I gave it up to Glenn. And then, of course, we have the famous Lenox Lounge, the famous Jazz Lounge. Its commercial rent shot up to $20,000 a month. And then, of course, as these box chains move into Harlem, and it will dominate the 125th Street commercial corridor from the east to west, from the Hudson River to the Harlem River, largely because of the rezoning of 125th Street, all supported by the elected officials in Harlem. Now, the average rent, just take a look at, hear this. The average retail rent in the second quarter of this year in Harlem was $100 per foot, up 33% from $75 the prior year quarter, which itself was a 50% increase in retail rates in 2010. Real estate brokers are predicting that commercial rents in Harlem may soon reach $175 per square foot. The biggest commercial corridors are, of course, again, 125th Street, Frederick Douglass Boulevard, Lenox Avenue, as well as Sugar Hill and 145th Street. Now, I just wanted to say just a little bit more about the gentrification process has been ongoing since the turn of the century in Harlem. And if I could just have some time here, because I want to point out this notion of getting rid of blacks and poor people in Manhattan, out of New York City, because the oligarchy of New York City determined that it was not profitable to have poor people living on expensive real estate. And that has been the policy in New York City since the turn of the century. That has been the policy that led to deindustrialization and the confluence of fire, finance, insurance, and real estate that dominates the financial corridors of New York City. It is and has produced this epicenter of financial international finance capital in New York City. And I just want to read to you what some of the stuff that was said at the turn of the century in terms of these folks. Now, in 1929, and we were talking in 1929, really, this was after the crash, the 1929 Regional Plan of New York City and its environment put forth a vision for New York City that called for massive deindustrialization for the express purpose of getting rid of the city's blue-collar workforce. The city blue-collar industry would be replaced with luxury apartments, office buildings, department stores, and expansions of hospitals and universities. And that is exactly what is happening in New York City. When you look at the expansion of Columbia University, a $5 billion, $5 to $6 billion project that is to that will be developed in West Harlem. 18 acres, we have the expansion of NYU, we have the expansion of Cornell University that is taking over Roosevelt Island. It is moving into East Harlem. The mop-up stage will produce a decline in the black population that within 10 years, I predict Harlem 60% black population will be reduced to 50 or 40%. That is the accelerated rate of this forced migration to the South, where this picture perfect, this rosy propaganda that we're receiving about blacks going to the South means absolutely nothing, because what we don't hear about are the poor and the working class in the South who live below the federal poverty line, and that is excluded from the narrative of prosperity, and blacks who are being forced out of the inner city, being part of this smokescreen, this rosy cover of them voluntarily returning to the South, living in huge homes and enjoying the good life. It is a lie, for in fact, we are all under the gun of gangster capitalism. And until, and hopefully in this conference with Black is Back, we will begin to strategize to reverse this trend, to reverse this political paradigm, and truly have a political end game of empowerment and principled politics that does not follow the Obama apologists, which is clearly not a path for us if we are truly talking about self-determination and black empowerment. Power to the people.
Thank you so much, Sister Comrade Nellie Bailey. So at this time, we're gonna open it up for discussion. We're gonna reduce the amount of time that we originally had for the discussion to make room for lunch. But for the next 5 minutes or so, we're gonna be open the floor up for discussion. So if anybody in the audience has any contributions. Also, as the chairman said early in this program, one of our goals is to come out of this process with resolutions. If there's any contributions that one may want to give during the Q&A process or discussion, if you want to offer up what you feel should be a resolution, that's more than welcome as well.
So I just had some comments, maybe that could lead to a question. But when Glenn was up there and he brought to me some correlations that we saw, and just in reference to the chairman and what he said too. Well, as a secretary of the Black is Back Coalition, and it's imperative, and I'm gonna push it, that we should definitely figure out a way that we all can be working toward an agenda to that. Just like the chairman had referenced, that POP, who had a 381-day campaign, is not just something that is taken up in Newark, but also is being taken up everywhere that we are. But that really, when you were talking about the electoral, the mayors and everything begging for capital for white folks to come back to the city, we can see at this thing, the same thing is happening even on the continent of Africa, where we have these new growth initiatives and economic growth initiatives that are being put forth, However, we're asking the oppressors, the former colonizers, to come back into Africa to use their money in order for us to gain some resources and get, you know, back on the capitalist money market. And that's really significant, that if we want to, I think that we can be here and show an example of that, even within Washington, D.C., where we have a microcosm of, I think, everything. We have different groups dealing with different issues that on different levels, and the importance of a coalition that can bring all those groups together so that we can not just work as separate entities, but work together in order to make something larger. And so that people aren't dealing with different groups, different interest groups, but they're dealing with one body, which can be formed within the Black is Back Coalition, and that's where I see its presence. And I also had one comment about Nellie, and you're talking about the removal of Black people in New York City, and I just wanted to just pinpoint Park Slope, which I saw a movie in like the late 70s, early 80s, and Park Slope was a disaster. It was just like really low income, and now it's primarily white, and now they're moving up Flatbush Avenue with the development there as well. So I think that in Washington, D.C., where I'm from, where I live also, the complete gentrification of the Black population there as well, with a removal of pretty much one side of the river where mostly all the Black people live, and pushing them into PG County, which is a suburb of Washington, D.C., but it's in Maryland. And this is really significant that it's not happening in just here or there, that it's happening all over, and that a coalition that brings all these issues together is what's really going to win and organize the people.
Greetings. My name is Charles Jones, and I'm a community activist. The presentation that both presenters gave was very informative. Basically, from the brother, Mr. Ford. My question is, you talked about the Black bourgeoisie. My question is, in your analysis, is there any value that the Black bourgeoisie can aid the formation or the struggle in the Black community? And if so, how would they be of value to talking about the black bourgeoisie? How can they be of value to their people who aspire to be bourgeoisie? I mean, it seems like you have a new generation that wants to reach the level or the position that the Black bourgeoisie is on. So if the majority of Blacks and poor minorities aspire to follow in the footsteps of Black bourgeoisie that's in the position right now, how can the Black bourgeoisie be of aid to change the mindset of our people that would give meaning to what we're struggling for?
The first, Nellie and I had a conversation about this subject just yesterday, and I'm glad to address that. But when we use this word bourgeoisie and petty bourgeoisie, and let's say petty bourgeoisie, we need to be careful about what we're talking about. In terms of the Black community, the petty bourgeois, the small business owner, the nightclub owner, the store owner, that class has almost ceased to exist. We live in the age that is marked by corporate consolidation, that big corporations
own every damn thing, including everything on the main thoroughfares of black neighborhoods, as Nellie was talking about, on 125th and all those other thoroughfares. The folk who we might be calling petty bourgeoisie are usually corporate operatives. They're working directly for corporations. They're not small business folk. The closest one could get would be someone who has a McDonald's franchise, but that means he's an extension of McDonald's. He's not an independent petty bourgeois entrepreneur. But what we see is that if we were trying to build a black city to accommodate our people's ambitions in terms of business, we would have to protect those petty bourgeois aspiring business owners from the corporations. Otherwise, they'd be eaten alive. So when we use this term, let's not imagine the old definition of the store owner or barbershop owner, etc. Let's talk about who these guys really are. And they're people who work for the big corporation. They're people who front for Prudential. They're people who have already thrown their lot in with these multinational companies like McDonald's, etc.
So we're going to have to, did you want to respond to that as well?
Yeah, I just want to say pretty quickly, I totally agree with Glen. What we were talking about is a black managerial class. They have no clout, they have no power. And if, in fact, they were in charge of a black institution, I'll give you a quick example. Carver National Bank, which used to be the oldest black bank in the country and certainly in New York, well, it no longer is because they gave out these loans and at the height of the real estate boom in Harlem, and then those loans to blacks mostly, those loans were defaulted on. And so now, who has Carver Bank? Wall Street. That's who has Carver Bank. And in Harlem, and I'm sure that this Harlem serves as a microcosm for other communities, if you look at every major cultural institution in Harlem, you know who heads up their board of directors? The Harlem Chamber of Commerce is chair is in fact a white businessman who doesn't even live in the community. That is how tight the control is. And let me just reference this brother who's no longer with us. I mean, his book gets a little bit. But Mamadou Chinlele wrote a book, Harlem Ain't Nothing But a Third World Country. Well, some of the facts in the book were wrong, but he was right on target with that title. And that's what it is. It is a plantation. And the oligarchy in New York City are even tired of their faithful servants. Look how they went after Rangel. Rangel was a crook for 41 years. He had those four apartments for over 20 years. Everybody knew that, but they tired of him. And he thought he was a member of the club, but he was not. And that's the way it is. And that's why the New York City oligarchy has bestowed respectability on charlatan Al Sharpton.
We're going to have to move the program forward because we do have lunch. We want to serve that. Before we do go into that, though, we want to make sure that we have a resolution, a proposed resolution coming out of this workshop right here. So we did hear a statement from the floor from Secretary Aisha in the form of a resolution. So I just want to make sure that we get that worded, you know, in the way that we would like for it to be proposed during the plenary. And there will be more time during the plenary itself to ask more questions and to flesh out this discussion. So Aisha, maybe you want to restate that proposal as you do other announcements. So that concludes this workshop right here. Uh-huh.
Well, so I wanna thank Nellie Bailey and Glen Ford for their presentations. If you could give them all a round of applause again. I have to I have to put together my resolution a little shorter shorter way, and then I can bring that to the plenary discussion this afternoon. But at this time, we are going to break for lunch. And lunch is being served at the back there. And please break also to visit our tables that are around the room. Up until now, we have not had a chance to really visit. And lunch is going to be served in the back, and it's $10 for a meal and a drink to support the caterer who has come out today. And if we can reconvene again at 2, what time is it now? In an hour. Are we going to have an hour for lunch, Rich? Rich, are we going to do an hour for lunch or 45 minutes? 45 minutes. What time is it now? Okay. Well, okay, so 2 o'clock we're going to reconvene. Thank you. Right now we are going to go into another panel discussing challenging the bourgeois electoral monopoly. And I'm going to bring to the stage the moderator for this panel. Is she ready? Okay, Comrade Gaida Cambone, who is the Secretary General of the African People's Socialist Party, is going to introduce our panelists and their topics of discussion. Over.
Uhuru, everybody. Black is back.
Black is back.
Say, black is back.
Black is back.
Black is back. Say it like it is. Is it or is it not? Black is back.
Black is back.
All right, that's what we need. Like Sister Aisha just announced, the name of this workshop is Challenging the Bourgeois Electoral Monopoly. We've been talking, and I think not a minute too soon. We have been really looking at this whole question of the electoral process and our participation in it. And I think that especially right now, you know, where we see campaigns calling for people to vote like your life depended on it, we have to help our people to understand what it means and how we should approach this question. And I think we had some good discussions. We had a brilliant political report this morning that kind of shed light on how we can empower ourselves when we approach this whole question of the electoral process. This workshop would have presentations made by 3 panelists, and then subsequent to that, we are going to use the 15 minutes to get some resolutions. And people will be able to ask questions, have participation in the plenary part of the process. The first person that's going to present on this workshop is Chimurenga Waller. And Chimurenga Waller is a NCC member of the African People's Socialist Party. He's on our central committee. And he's no stranger to the whole question of the electoral process. Chimurenga himself was a former candidate for Pinellas County School Board in St. Petersburg, Florida. And he was also a candidate for the St. Petersburg City Council. And Chimurenga took the aspirations of the community, the African community in Pinellas County, of St. Petersburg, took it into that process and shook up that process because we went in on our own terms and began to make everybody respond to us in terms of, you know, what the community needed. And all the candidates had to speak to that question. The other person that we're going to bring up to this panel is activist and Councilman Charles Barron. And brother Councilman Charles Barron is representing the 42nd District in New York City. And I remember when I first met Councilman Barron, which was many, 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 many years ago on Atlantic Avenue in the Black United Front. Yourself, myself, and Aranda Takuma. But you know, here we have him today, and he's gonna give you some insights and talk about the courageous battles that he waged in terms of in the interest of the African community in New York City. The last person on the panel, everybody's heard about, since we've been here and even before we've been here, and that is Brother Chairman Lawrence Ham, whose organization, is he here? Oh, there he is. And this is the chairman of the organization, the People's Organization for Progress, POP as we call it, that had just successfully completed 381 consecutive days of protest in New Jersey. POP's People's Campaign for Jobs, Peace, Equality, and Justice built an opposition to the oppressive public policies, including economic policies and practices that exploited the African community and colonial wars carried out by the United States government. And that was a magnificent, magnificent mobilization. It taught us that, you know, like in the olden days, we had staying power, we can be effective. So these are the three panelists, and I just want you to give them a hand, and then we'll move on into the first discussion. Kimarenga, you'll be the first person.
Uhuru. As Gaida said, I'm Chimarenga Waller. I belong to the African People's Socialist Party. And as she mentioned, I was a candidate for city council twice and also for the Pinellas County School Board in 2000. We learned a lot of things during that period of running in elections. We hadn't done that much as a strategy for moving the liberation of African people forward. And in 2000, in the county where I'm from, in Pinellas County, a lot of issues around education with African people. And of course, that's everywhere. You will find that. In Pinellas County, you may be aware that the highest rate of African men not graduating with regular diplomas is in Pinellas County. St. Petersburg, Florida, where our national headquarters is located in Pinellas County. So we have a dire situation there in terms of education. And in 1998, we actually put forward a charter school program that Pinellas County School Board said was one of the best they had ever seen, and then they promptly denied it. And they denied it because they said it was going to be a majority African school and that that was not be allowed in Pinellas County. And then, although they had no such rules to that effect at the time, later on they went to a judge who said, make up some rules. And then they made up some rules to say, no, you can't have this charter school. So that was the context in which we ran somebody for Pinellas County School Board. And it was interesting because I didn't know a lot about running for office. I had never done that before. And I remember when I went into the first candidate forum, all I had was a business card. And I didn't have a flyer, a poster, anything. I didn't have a clue what I was supposed to be doing, right? So I went in there with my wife. Anybody know anything about Pinellas County in Florida? Well, it's a very white county, I can tell you that. So the northern part of the county is even whiter. So I was in a place called Top Run Springs at the first candidate forum I went to. And me and my wife was the only black people in there. It was about 300 people in there. So when I got up to speak, I started saying, well, the real issues in this campaign is that African children are not being educated, that the whole education system is hostile to African children. It was a very silent kind of response, to say the least. But a very interesting thing happened at the end of that forum. It took me about 30 minutes to leave there because the white people mobbed me. They didn't try to kill me. What happened was, because it was a Republican Party campaign forum, they felt like I was making the criticism of the NAACP and this desegregation order that they couldn't do. So they felt like, hey, this is the guy that we need. So they tried to recruit me into the Republican Party. I was like, no, that won't work. What we did was say, what we have here is a convergence of interest. We don't believe that busing African children all over Pinellas County is going to get African children educated. And you don't want busing either, but you don't want it for a different reason. And I don't really care. If both of us have a convergence of interest, that's how we move. You don't have to love me. And it really excited a lot of voters about saying, look, this is about practical interest. This is not about whether you like me or I like you. Although it upset a number of the candidates. And interestingly enough, some of the candidates were saying, you can't keep saying that. You can't keep saying that black students are being failed in Pinellas County. You can't keep saying that. I was like, why not? Well, you can't say that because nobody will vote for you. Well, I said, I'm going to tell the truth and see what happens. So we did that. We got about 10,000 votes in that election. About, 10,000 votes. It's about 10% of the vote. But it was a very interesting campaign, and we ran it on little experience, little money. The candidate didn't have a clue what he was doing, but we had a program, and we did it based on the interests of the African community, and our organization made that decision. Different from when people just jump up and say, I want to be a candidate for this and that. Our organization sat down and said, these are the issues we need to drive, so we're going to run somebody for school. And that's what I hope one day that the Black is Back will do. They will start searching for their own candidates, identifying candidates within the organization who can make those kind of moves, groom them along the way, and then we create our own candidates. Because we are not in a position where we can depend on the Cory Bookers of the world to, you can't. You can't say, let me tell you a little story. I remember somebody came to one of our meetings during the campaign in 2008 for the presidential campaign, and the woman was really disturbed by our position around Barack Obama. She pleaded with us, well, you know, he can't say certain things because he hasn't been elected yet. So after he gets elected, then he'll be able to say all these things. But Barack Obama meant exactly what he said, and he had no interest for African people whatsoever, and his commercials proved that, of course. Did you ever see anybody black in any of the commercials that Barack Obama ran? No. So the interest of the African community is really what we were fighting for, and that's what we told the person who was at our meeting, and that's what we have to do. And when we challenge the bourgeois dominance over the electoral politic, we have to enter these elections with our own candidates. That is absolutely going to be necessary, because some of the things that were mentioned earlier by some of the other workshop presenters, such as gerrymandering, that happened. In 2005, I ran for the St. Petersburg City Council, and right before that election, they actually changed the district so that it would no longer be 58% African. They changed it to be 53% African. Now, an African named Ernest Williams had been appointed to that seat shortly before the election. And guess who signed off on the paper to change it from 58 to 53%? Ernest Williams. Now, Ernest Williams is not a very smart man. We knew that going in. He's just an empty suit. He didn't know anything. And I'm not sure he knew his difference was going to be 53% African. Some white person probably came to him and said, boy, sign this paper. And he signed the paper. And then he almost lost an election because he did it. As a matter of fact, he lost the primary to a white woman. And the St. Petersburg Times and the other financial interests went crazy. I was in that election as well. There were three other candidates besides the white woman and Ernest Williams. And that election, I should tell you, got very interesting. And it was connected to my 2001 run for city council, in which I finished second among five candidates. And I got into a runoff. It was a big disparity in votes, but I got into a runoff, and the St. Petersburg Times newspaper wrote these articles. I think that was the time the chairman was running for mayor. They wrote these articles saying, well, the Uhurus don't have any support. And what the story really was, how did a candidate with a radical platform calling for rent controls, calling for economic development in the African community as opposed to economic extraction, how could a candidate like that end up in a runoff with a status quo candidate? Not how we lost by such a large margin. So when we start defining what victory is, it doesn't always mean, like was mentioned earlier, doesn't always mean that we're going to have more votes than the other people. Sometimes we're going to drive issues. Sometimes we're going to drive issues and make everybody else discuss it. And that is what has happened in the elections that I have run in. I would say that what we will see happening, and I think we should really have this discussion so we know what is going to be in the discussion as we identify candidates, groom them, and run them in an election. When I ran for the school board, there was a Republican and a Democrat. These are nonpartisan elections in Pinellas County. But when I ran, there were Democrats and Republicans fundraising for all the other candidates, and you know, to stop me. After I got into the runoff in the city council, for city council, both Republican and Democrats were fundraising together to stop me. So it proved the two sides are not that different. They're the same thing. It's just two faces of the same thing. So in 2005, when I ran for city council, that was a very interesting election. Now, I was coming out of the 2001 election where I'd gotten into the runoff. So the bourgeoisie, they were very intimidated by the possibilities that I could win that election. And so they wrote about the election sort of in general and, you know, sort of wrote about me as this anomaly among these candidates. But in the last 8 days of the election for city council, they wrote 10 articles with my name in it. 10. And none of them said that I was the right candidate. All of these articles were attacking articles. You know, they were using innuendos and saying, well, this person came to the campaign forum and said, made anti-gay remarks, and that person was with campaign people from the Waller campaign. It was just an attack, a blistering attack. You would have thought it was a presidential election. So these are the kind of things that we will have to face as we move forward, but that's what helps us to understand that we don't just run a candidate necessarily to win the election. We are winning our objectives. That's what we have to put in place as we pick our candidates and groom them. So there's going to be a resolution. I have one myself that I would like to put forward in terms of the strategy of the Black is Back for challenging the bourgeois dominance of these of electoral politics. Gaida, I don't know if it's time for the, would you like to get everybody up there first before we do? Okay. But, so I think that, I think the way the chairman described it was a great strategy. It cannot be the only strategy that we use. Electoral politics is only one strategy that we use to make this fight happen for the liberation of African people. It cannot be a singular strategy. So what we want to do is put it in an arsenal, so to speak, of all kinds of things, on the ground outreach, forums, events, demonstrations, all of that go into that pool of tactics that we use to liberate our people. And of course, we'll talk about other options later, but I think that we have to be clear that electoral politics can be and is an important tactic to use as we move forward. It allows us to put the issues that we believe in, the issues of liberation of African people, reparations, all those kind of issues on the table. Charles Barron has done that in New York. The unfortunate thing is not that many Charles Barrons. That's the problem. So what we have to do is organize that, to change that. So our organization is the actual institution that's building candidates, promoting them, funding them. That way they're not, obligated to Wall Street and all these other corporations. They're not obligated to anybody but the African community. So I want to express my appreciation for people listening to me. There are plenty of stories that I can tell about Pinellas County. It has a very strange electoral system in city council. They have at-large voting in the general election, and then they have single member district voting for the primary, which is crazy. Only the district can vote in the primary, and then in the general election, it's at-large voting. All these white people get to vote for the Black candidate, so if they don't like them, they can reverse the decision of the Black people. So it's a very interesting situation, but I want to express my appreciation to current Secretary General Gaida Cambone and all of you in the Black is Back for inviting me to give some of my experiences and my input into this process. Uh-huh.
I want to thank Tamaringa for that presentation. And one thing that it, as you were presenting, and I was sitting there, that it really brought up for me is the significance of the BIB coalition. Because if we're going to be in this process, we have to be in it strategically. And I think the thing that Tamaringa was talking about in terms of how we can really get everywhere we are, begin to groom people and put them in there to get our agenda and these platforms all around the country. You know, I think that's a really important thing. That's not something that we should play down. Next, I want to bring up Councilman Charles Barron, who's going to be our next presenter.
Uhuru. Black power. Black is back. You know, I'm glad y'all talking black, because this show is lonely out here sometimes. Not hearing people want to talk black. People talking about race neutral politics. You know, race neutral politics means you're supporting white nationalism, because there's nothing neutral. It can't be neutral. Race neutral politics means you're supporting white interests. I want to talk about my city council stuff in my last congressional run. I'm still going to my mailbox traumatized to see what kind of mail is coming in. And I'm nervous and open up the newspapers, not knowing what I might see. But I'm recovering, y'all. I'm recovering. It was fun. See, you know what, I had to get mad at me because I don't let that faze me in the least. They think they be hitting you and they think you're wounded. Then when I see them, I say, hey, how y'all doing? Yeah, we gonna get you next time, you know? See you in the streets. When I run around the streets, you would thought I won. Because I did. I got 11,000 votes in spite of all of that stuff. I did win. I did win. I got to acknowledge the chairman, Omali Yeshiteli. You know, it's a breath of fresh air when you still have people committed to revolution, to radical change, to reparations, freeing political prisoners, and still engaging in the electoral arena with that, not changing to win, but demanding to win on our terms. So, Chairman, I congratulate you for that, and I commend you for that. I commend you for that. To one of my heroes, who was in the audience with his wife, Amina, Mary Baraka. He is a hero of mine, and one that I, that's right, give it up for Mary. He's been out there for a while for us. I do appreciate you and Sister Amina for all the work that y'all have done, and your son, Ross Baraka. Ross Baraka, for being in Newark. I think there's about 277,000 people in Newark, and 90 or 80% of them are black and Latino, 50-some-odd percent black, I think 30-some-odd percent Latino. They have 9 members on the city council, 5 blacks, 4 Latinos. We just got to get everybody black, black, and everybody Latino, Latino, so they could join Ross and we can get something done. That's the problem. And I'm going to talk about that in a minute. So it's good to have him. And my brother Larry Ham, I've always, always been inspired by your work. And brother Chimarenga, keep running, man. And he's talking about he got 10,000 votes. I didn't get that many to win my city council seat, man. When 10,000 people, and I think I saw this in Brother Ford's articles, when 10,000 people vote for one of us, they're voting for radical politics. They're voting for radical politics. So they're making a statement that we're ready. We just got to get our apparatus better so that we can reach more with our message, because people are ready to hear us. You know, I've been rereading a book that I read in the 60s by Dr. Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah. And that is neocolonialism, the last stage of imperialism. Neocolonialism, the last stage of imperialism. And that's what we're up against. That's what we're up against. That's what we're up against. So when we get out there, you know, you may not even face white folk anymore. You gotta face the neocolonial puppets that are in the city councils, that are in the state assemblies, that are in the White House, that are in the congressional seats. So when you know that in Africa, when the colonists were there, literally, whites were there, the prime ministers took over the political system, the economy, the navy, the army, and everything, they were there, then when the overwhelming majority of Africans started to rise up in Mau Mau movements and Sekou Touré and Julius Nyerere and Kwame Nkrumah, when they all started rising up, then the white colonialists said, wait a minute, we lost. We got to find another way to control. So let's get some black puppets, set up a black puppet government, give them a flag, let them have political power or positions, but that economy, the land, the army, the police, we will control from Europe. We're gonna go back to the world, we're gonna leave. And you know, anytime somebody grants you independence, you're not free. If you don't take it, you're not free. You're not free. So they went through that period, but the good thing about neocolonialism, if there's anything good that can come out about it, the good thing about it is that you gotta front black people now, because you're losing. Because you're losing, so you have to put forth a black face on white policies and issues and interest, because people have peeped your whole card. The whole world is rising up against you. So now you have to put a face on it to make it appear that we're making progress. So in New York City, a city of 8 million people, 2.7 million Latinos, 2.3 million Latinos, this is their statistics, so you just got to add stuff to their statistics, 2.3 million Latinos, 1.8 million Africans, 1 million Asians, and 2.7 million whites. 2.7 million whites. Blacks, Latinos, and Asians are 62% of New York City. That's why maybe I shouldn't have gone to Washington. I'm gonna stay right there in New York City and handle my business. We'll see. Then you have a city council. See, this is why I want to propose to us a city council strategy across the country. That's very local, very doable. Very doable. It's going to be more challenging to get the congressional seats and the statewide seats or become a governor or a mayor. Those can happen, but that's going to be a little more challenging. But on the city council levels across the country, we are the majority in a lot of places in this country. Newark is one of them. We just got to get Ross Baraka 8 more of us. Because he's there by himself, radical, conscious, with 8 neo-colonialists. So we have to get Ross Baraka, start, help him in his movement here, to get 2 or 3 more African, conscious, radical, revolutionary people on the city council here in Newark. Especially in a city where we're 80% of the population. Then there's Brother Chokwe Lumumba in Jackson, Mississippi. 183,000 people in Jackson, 80% of them are black. They only have 7 city council members. And Chokwe is one of them. We just got to get rid of the 6 neo-colonialists to help Chokwe out. I'm thinking we do a, Chairman, if we do a national city council local strategy, because if they can get Chokwe in and Ross in, I got in New York, and that ain't no easy task, we can now take this all over. Sister Joanne Watson from Detroit, she's a progressive sister, very conscious, black, conscious, progressive. There are 9 council members in Detroit, 82%. Of the population in Detroit is African, black people. All 9 council members are black, but there's only 1 or 2 real blacks. We gotta get rid of the other 6 or 7 neo-colonialists. We gotta get rid of the neo-colonialists. We gotta get rid of the neo-colonialists. Come to New York City, we have I live in the most powerful city on the planet. The richest city on the planet is New York City. We, people of color, blacks, Latinos, and Asians, are the new majority in the population, even with the miscount. We're the majority. In the last election in November, 56% of the people that actually came out to vote were us. So we're even the majority that comes out to vote. City Council, we have 51 members of the City Council in New York. The power of the City Council, we pass the budget, not the mayor. Y'all can talk about Bloomberg all you want. He doesn't have a vote on the budget. He can only propose it, like they do in most places. Where do they propose the city's budget to? The city council. Newark, the city council. Everywhere, it's the city council. And the good thing about the city council strategy, if you deal on a federal level, you're talking about a bicameral system, a house and a senate, 435 members of the House of Representatives, 43 blacks. 100 U.S. senators, no blacks. None. 535 members of Congress, 43 in the House, none in the Senate. You can't get nothing passed unless you pass it the House and the Senate. On the state level, there's an assembly and a senate bicameral. New York City, we got 150 members of the assembly, 63 members of the senate. Only 40 some odd percent of them are black and Latino, and only 13 of the senators are black and Latino. Bicameral. And the city council is a unicameral body. One body. You don't have to go to another house, a senate, or nothing. It's one body. You get the majority of the votes in that, that's it. So in New York, we have a $68.5 billion budget. You hear what I said? New York City's budget is larger than every African country's budget. New York City's budget is larger than every Caribbean country's budget, every Latin American country's budget, many European countries' budget, many Asian countries. New York City's budget is larger than 48 state budgets in the United States. New Jersey's budget is $29, $30 billion. New York City's budget is twice as large as the state of New Jersey. And who sits on New York City Council? 14 blacks. Well, you know, 13 neo-colonialists and one African. 14, 11 Latinos, that's 25, 2 Asians, that's 27, and 24 whites. You hear me? 24 whites. We passed the $68 billion budget, we passed all the laws, and we determine land use. City-owned land. Do you know in my black East New York, if Donald Trump came to my neighborhood and said that he wanted to build Trump Towers on Blake Avenue on city-owned land, he has to come see the Black Panther. He has to come see the Black Panther. And I don't bite my tongue. I don't bite my tongue. You know what I have in my office? When all of the white developers have to come, so I don't got to suck up to nobody, they better suck up to me. So when they come, Chairman, I got to invite you to my office so y'all can see it, so you don't think I'm lying. Don't think I'm fronting for my revolutionary friends. When you come to my office, first you're going to see a red, black, and green flag. You know, I had to battle over that. When I got to my office, they had the American flag in there and the flag of New York City. I'm never going to use the flag of New York City because that's the same flag from South Africa, because the Dutch who colonized South Africa were here in New York City first. Remember? New Amsterdam. So I said, get that flag out of here. And they said, Councilman, no, these are the rules of the city council. You have to have the city council flag and you have to have the American flag. I threw them both out of my office and I have the red, black, and green flag in my office. That was my number one battle. The other thing, I got a chance to visit Venezuela and meet Hugo Chavez and his folk, and I got a chance to go to Cuba and all of that. So I had these nice little heads, you know, these busts of Hugo Chavez, Che Guevara, and Fidel Castro. So I put them right up front, so when the developer has to sit down, you know, he's looking right at them. So, and I always introduce them, meet my three amigos. These are my friends. These are my friends. These are my friends. Then I have a picture of Dr. Khalid Muhammad. I have a picture of, you know, all of the radical, anybody radical I could find. You know, I said, I may not get a vote through, but they're gonna have to come to my office and sit through this. But just think, if Donald Trump wanted to do that, he has to come see me. He could have $1 trillion. But he doesn't have the power to build Trump Towers unless he could buy me off. Because the power of the city council member in that direct district, and they all will support you, is the one who decides what's being built on city-owned land. Right now, a black radical revolutionary, Charles Barron, is the number one city council member in building real affordable housing in the borough of Brooklyn. No other council member has done better, none. And I make sure when them developers come in, they say, A councilman, 5 minutes? Oh man, that's just my intro. Okay, let me hurry up. When they come in and they wanted the land thing, because the land is critical. They show me all these colorful pictures. I said, get out of here, put the pictures away. How much? How much are you charging my people for rent or that house? And if they don't say it right, this meeting is terminated until you come back with the right price. And then when they come back with the right price, then I said, what is the required income? This is how they do gentrification, through income. What is the AMI, the area median income, required to get in this apartment building? If they tell me 80% of the AMI, I know that's $60,000 for a family of four. My East New York AMI is $28,000. This meeting is terminated. And I get them down to what we need for our community. East New York and New York City is the only black community where the black population increased by 13.2%. Bedford, Stuyvesant, Harlem, everywhere else, gentrified, the black communities' population is going down. And they cite in the daily news that beats me up every other day that is affordable housing that causes the people to want to live in East New York. So brothers and sisters, I think we should go through this electoral movement. Electoral politics is not a panacea. That is not going to get us to the revolutionary ends. This system has to be radically altered. This system has to be restructured so that it is more socialist and human needs over human greed. There's no way. See, the failure of some of us when we think policies cannot save capitalism. Radical altering of the entire system, and electoral politics is just a tactic that's used. Don't think because they deregulated Wall Street that if we regulate Wall Street, we'll be all right. Don't think because of the lack of policies in this system. If you go that route and think it's deregulation or even taxing the rich, because they'll do that. They'll tax the rich and they'll regulate Wall Street and they'll give you some form of some health care that still has the insurance companies laughing their way to the bank. But the bottom line is until you realize that the problems we're having with the economy, the problems we're having in our community is capitalism itself. It's capitalism itself. So we who believe that have to use this as a tactic to get in it. And while we're raising the issues, whether it's reparations, we need jobs, you know, we need affordable housing, we need health care and all of that, our people are in pain. Part of the failure of our movement is that we're in a dual struggle, a struggle for survival and a struggle for liberation. And 90% of our people are in that struggle for survival, and they don't see our liberation forums like this as a means toward their survival. We haven't made that connection for them yet. So they feel that, hey, y'all can talk all of this radical stuff if you want. I need a job. I need a job. So if I can get in there and I get, no matter what they say, no matter what they, because they can't do anything about this, as a city council member, I ran hard. You know, I was like Jim Moran. I didn't know what I was doing. My first time I ran in 97, I didn't even know you were supposed to call the unions to try to get support. I just was out there running. And I got 4,000 votes. My opponent incumbent got 6,000. Then it was an open seat. I stayed out there organizing with my people. You can't win this stuff if you're not connected to the masses. The Black Panther Party taught me you got to meet the needs of the masses, whether you're feeding them breakfast or taking care of their health care. You better produce some needs, because if you don't, the neo-colonialists will. And they will have resources to do it. So when I got in and I finally won by 300 some odd votes, they were saying, how did he do it? Being black, radical, and whatever your positions is on Robert Mugabe, he has some critique. I brought him to City Hall. They had a fit. I went into the speaker's office and I said, you know, I need to secure the red room. The red room is the most prestigious room next to the chambers itself in the city. He said, oh, sure, no problem. I said, it's available? He said, yeah. He said, who are you bringing? I said, a president of an African country. Would you believe that, man? He said, right on, that's nice. Who is it? I said, President Robert Mugabe. He said, no, you're not doing that to me, Charles. I said, doing that to you. See, this is how they think. Why would you bring your politics to me? You? I'm bringing them to City Hall. That's the people's place. It ain't your place. You're just a speaker. I don't see you like the other ones see you. You're just a little facilitator, not a dictator. You know, you said the room is available, then he will be there. He got so angry, he told all the other council members, don't go to that affair. Don't go. So, you know, I pushed it. President Mugabe came, media all over the place, you know, having a little African stuff on. And I was like, come on in, you know, Mr. President. Because the other problem he had is that when he goes back to Zimbabwe and the reactionary forces that they align against him say, look, he couldn't even meet with no politician. He had to go in a church in Harlem because nobody respects this president. Now he can go back and say, I was in the number one city in the world and an elected official brought me into their chambers. Because what I did after I got him into the red room, which is the second most prestigious room, I made him go upstairs in the chambers. I said, is the chambers available? They said, well, you didn't secure it. I said, is it available? And they said, yes. I said, come on, y'all, let's go upstairs. So all over they had, oh boy, they talked about me like a dog. But I brought Mugabe there. I get $2 million every year of capital money, so I'm able to renovate parks. I'm able to smooth out some of the streets. $2 million, and that's low. I'm low because I'm fighting, but they don't want to put me too far down. $2 million, I get $400,000 a year to kick out for programs and stuff, and I look for revolutionary people. I get $300,000 a year to hire staff. That's why we could hire Viola Plummer and Omawale Clay and put people on our staff that are revolutionaries. Of course, they fired Viola illegally because her and I was fighting so well. So what we did, we got my wife elected to the state assembly and hired Viola to be her chief of staff. So now Viola's working in her office. They ain't stopping us. Let me wrap it up with this. So we got to do that. I've been able to do a lot, and one day I really want you, the chairman, and I want y'all to come to my East New York one year, and I want to take you around to actually see how we transform the infrastructure of East New York with radical politics. So I want to have that happen so you can see it concretely and not just at a forum, but see it with your own eyes. Finally, in this last election, the first never before in the annals of New York State politics have they ever aligned the power of powerful forces to stop one broke candidate. Didn't have no money. I only had $100,000. You need $500,000 just to finish respectfully. I had $100,000 and 100 workers. And we were working hard. This is a district of 717,000 people, you know. So we worked it. When I was running, they thought I was gonna win. See, this is the second time I ran for Congress. The first time I ran against the incumbent, shocked them with $135,000 to his million. I got 15,000 votes to the incumbent's 19,000. They threw in Roger Green, an assemblyman, his buddy, to take 6,000 votes away from us. The first time the incumbent at Towns was under 50% of the vote, and that was in 2006. We 2008, we got my wife elected. I ran again in 2012. Now when Towns ducked out and was just me and the other brother, and nobody knew him, and all of a sudden, all of the polls were saying I had it. All of the polls were saying I had it. So we was rolling. They panicked. First, the Jews got hysterical because I went to Gaza and I delivered humanitarian aid to suffering people in Gaza. Now, I can tell you all this now because and my strategy was every time they asked me, you know, about all my past quotes, because I know I said a lot of stuff. So when they asked me about the quotes, I said, excuse me, this is a sophisticated level and I want you to talk to me about the complexities of the economic system. and foreign policies, not quotes. Because the district is suffering, so I'd rather than say, yeah, I said it, or no, I didn't say it. Didn't you say that Israel was the worst terrorist government in the world? If you want to talk to me about foreign policy, it starts with Africa, not Israel. So let's have this discussion. I said that, y'all. I have to confess, I did say that. They said, did you say Gaza was like the concentration camps that the Israel suffered? I'm not talking about Israel. We're talking about foreign policy. I said that too. They said that, do you want to slap the first white man you see for your black mental health? Now, let me say to y'all that I was at a reparations rally with Viola and them. They got me in trouble. They invited me there. They knew I was a city council member. How dare they invite me to something like that, Chairman? So when I got up, I'll never forget that rally. It was about 60, 70,000 people. And I remember Minister Farrakhan spoke and Jesse and a few others. But the people were like moving around. And I was saying, wow, how come they're not being cool for the speakers? Bob Law was moderating it. So I got up there half playing, half serious. I said, y'all be still. Trying to get our reparations. And you walk around, everybody got to tell you to move to the center and be still. Be still. And they got quiet. I said, well, now what am I going to say? So I said, reparations, we marching for reparations. We need to go to the Treasury Department. Let's take our reparations. Now, they don't even have money at the Treasury Department. They just print checks. So I'm just talking trash. And then I said, you know, when I get back to New York for my black mental health, I'm going to slap the first white man I see and tell him it's a black thing. And they'll think, yay! I forgot about ABC, New York One, NBC. So I saw all of that, so I said, oh my God. So when I got back to New York, oh man, the media, my colleagues were saying, where were you this weekend? I said, I was in Washington. They said, well, what did you say? I said, I was talking about reparations. They said, man, they're calling for your head. They want us to vote you out of the city council. Then I had to do this conservative radio program in the morning. I promised them I'd do that. So they got on and they said, Councilman, how are you? How you feeling today? So they want to see how you're feeling. I said, great. It's a great time to be alive. I feel great. So they said, we have a quote from the Associated Press. I'm going to slap the first white man I see for my black mental health. Did you say that? I said, absolutely. Absolutely. So they said, well, Councilman, what do you mean by that? So just to mess with them, I said, it was a case of oratorical improvisation and black hyperbole. So they said, oratorical improvisation and black hyperbole. So he said, Mary, he said, what's a black hyperbole? I said, well, sir, a hyperbole is a figure of speech. You know, you have metaphors, you have similes, and you have hyperbole. So I said, hyperbole is a gross exaggeration. That's what a hyperbole is. And he said, I know what a hyperbole is. I said, why'd you ask me? So why'd you ask me? He said, tell me what a black hyperbole is. I said, well, when I was growing up, my mama told me on Sunday, if I didn't stop getting on her nerve, she was going to slap me into Tuesday. I said, now, sir, that didn't mean Monday wasn't going to happen. That's a hyperbole. And he said, tell me another one. I said, well, my mama told me I brought you in this world. That is not my mother's commitment to murder. That's a hyperbole. That's a hyperbole. So he said, oh, so you were just joking. I said, hey, my mama wasn't playing with me, and I ain't playing with y'all. Black power.
Oh, my goodness. Whoa. Hyperbole, huh? Well, okay, next on the agenda, we're going to bring up Chairman Lawrence Ham.
Black is back.
Black is back.
Black is back.
Black is back.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Power to the people.
Power to the people.
Power to the people.
A very glad to be here at this historic Black is Back conference. And let me say, first of all, how fitting it is that we're here today to talk about how to increase Black political power through the electoral process. And we have the matriarch and the patriarch of Black power here, Amina and Amiri Baraka, sitting in the audience. They are the living heroes of the Black power movement, not just in Newark, New Jersey, across the country. And I want everybody to know that I would not be standing here today. I dare say there may not even be a People's Organization for Progress if it wasn't for Amiri Baraka and his contributions. I also want to thank Chairman Omali Yashitela. And I want to tell you something. I was so moved by the fact that you had our daily campaign for jobs, peace, equality, and justice in the Black is Back slideshow. But I want everybody to know that we had the endorsement of 172 organizations for that campaign. But the first organization and the first person to endorse that campaign was Omali Yashitela. And that's when it was just an idea. And I want you to know, Chairman, that when you and I discussed it, it was just a thought. It was an idea. But that we successfully carried out 381 consecutive days of protests for jobs, peace, equality, and justice. And I know all of you thought the campaign was over. The first wave was over. The campaign, the 381-day campaign for jobs, peace, equality, and justice ended on July 11th. We had started on June 27th, 2011. We went 381 days and ended with a massive rally on the 381st day with a large contingent from the Newark branch of Black is Back, and I want you to give them a big hand, the Newark branch of Uhuru in Peetum, Black is Back. But on July the 12th, we held the observance for the Newark Rebellion. See, that's one of our traditions here in Newark, New Jersey. You remember now, there were rebellions all over the country. As a matter of fact, people thought the revolution was right around the corner in the 1960s. Many people don't understand how many rebellions there were. There were over 1,000 urban uprisings in the United States between 1960 and 1972. And in Newark, New Jersey, we don't hide the fact that there was a rebellion. We celebrate the fact there was a rebellion. We celebrate it every year. And we ended the 381-day campaign on July 11th, and on July 12th, we had our observance. And we marched from the spot where we had our daily protests. We marched from there to the monument that has the names of the 26 people who were killed during the rebellion to try to make that connection between the past and the present, and the fact that the struggle is not over, the struggle continues today, every day. But then on July the 13th, we began a second wave of daily protests. And I am proud to say, brothers and sisters, that when we combine the 381 days with the last 30 days, We've had nearly 425 days of protests here in the city of Newark. And we're going to continue as long as we can, because you all know our history. We embrace electoral politics, but we believe that the primary task is to build the mass movement, and electoral politics must rest on a strong mass movement in our community, a movement in the streets. So I just want to give a little bit of history. We talk about the challenge to electoral politics, the challenge to bourgeois electoral politics. Newark is a good example of that, because we had apartheid here in Newark, New Jersey. Don't call it Jim Crow. If you're gonna call it in South Africa apartheid, call it apartheid here. Call it the same thing. It's a system of racial segregation and domination. And we had that in Newark. We had apartheid in Newark. A predominantly black city only had one black elected representative, and that was Irvin Turner. And then some brothers came together and formed the United Brothers in 1966. And Ken Gibson ran for mayor the first time and lost. But what happened the following year? There was an uprising in Newark. An uprising, and the reason we say uprising and not a riot, because if it was a riot, it could have been put down by the police in a day, maybe less than that. But it was an uprising. All the police couldn't put it down. They had to call in 700 state troopers. They couldn't put it down. They couldn't put it down. They had to call in the army, and the army, we know about occupation. We were occupied in Newark, New Jersey by the military, where martial law was declared in this city. And that uprising created the consciousness that was needed to begin the political transformation. And the effort of that transformation was led by Amiri Baraka, first the United Brothers, and then the Committee for a Unified Newark. And they did it through a convention process. See, it just didn't happen. It wasn't just somebody's individual effort. It was a collective effort, a collective effort. It wasn't somebody's personal political ambition only. It was a collective effort. The week after the rebellion, a Black Power conference was held in Newark, New Jersey, while we were under martial law. And then after that, not far from here, just across town, we had the Black Power convention at West Kenny Junior High School. It's still there. And then after that, we had the Black and Puerto Rican convention, because we knew we had to make alliances and coalitions to be successful. And out of that effort came the community's choice team. See, they were all together. Sharp James, Ken Gibson, Dennis Westbrooks, and so on. And because we built a broad unity movement, out of those conventions, Newark had the first black mayor of a major East Coast city in 1970. And that's why all these people walking around here today, they want to attack Amiri Baraka. They wouldn't have their jobs if it hadn't been for Amiri Baraka and the Committee for a Unified Newark that got Ken Gibson elected. And we also had a student movement at that time. See, we have to understand the dialectic between the mass movement and the electoral process. We have to have both, because one makes the other stronger. They reinforce each other. And we had a student movement in Newark. And in 1971, students from all over the city marched down and took over the Gateway Hotel. And they were led by a 17-year-old student activist from Arts High named Larry Hand. And they sent everybody to get the students. We took over the 6th and 7th floors of the Gateway Hotel, the same hotel that's down there across the street from Penn Station, to try to end the teacher strike at that time, to get the board and the union to negotiate. And Ken Gibson came to us and he said, well, if you leave,
I'll get the two parties together and we'll end the strike and you guys can graduate and go on and live your lives. And then a month later, when I had just graduated from Arts High School, Ken Gibson asked me to sit on the Board of Education. I became the youngest school board member in the history of the United States of America. I wasn't even old enough to vote, but it wasn't because of my personal desire and ambition. There was a movement. There was a mass movement in the community. There was a student movement. And when you have movement, movement is what makes change. Well, Ken Gibson appointed me, but this young person from Arts High School was appointed. He said his first commitment was to the black community. And one of the things the students asked they wanted to do was to be able to bring the red, this was in 1971, to bring the red, black, and green flag to school, to be able to put it up in the classrooms. I made a motion on the board, it became the policy, and Ken Gibson said that was the worst appointment he had ever made. This is the truth. But the following year in 1972, Chairman O'Malley, I should tell him, mentioned this earlier. There was the National Black Political Convention held in Gary, Indiana. And it was convened by three people at that time. Richard Hatcher, mayor of Gary, Indiana. Charles Diggs, congressman from Detroit. And our own Amiri Baraka. And they convened the National Black Political Convention, I believe it was it Central High or West Side High? Central High School in Gary, Indiana. And you know, when the black flag issue came up, my poor mother, she would sit at home and the vice president of ABC television would come on and editorialize and tell her what a terrible person her son was for bringing the red, black, and green. There should only be one flag, the American flag. But let me tell you, the best feeling I had was when we came to Gary, we rode down the main boulevard of Gary, Indiana, to Central High School. Dick Hatcher had red, black, and green flags flying from every light post in Gary, Indiana in March of 1972. I was 18 years old then. I was probably the youngest delegate. And that was a convention process. People just didn't come to Gary. There were conventions held at the city level, at the county level, at the state level, and then the national political convention. Let me tell you, when I came to Gary, I thought I was in the black parliament. I mean, black people were passing policies. Hundreds of black elected people who had been elected, not elected officials, grassroots people who had been elected. I was so transfigured by that experience. After that, I asked Amiri Baraka to give me an African name. He gave me the name Adimu Chunga. So when I got back home, when they had the board dais, you know, with all the board members, I took out Lawrence Ham and I put in Adimu Chunga. That same year, 1972, Newark attempted to elect, well, the 10th Congressional District attempted to elect its first black congressperson. See, Donald Payne was not the first candidate. He was the first one to win. But the first major campaign to get a black person elected to Congress out of this district was when Bill Hart, the mayor of East Orange, was the Unity Movement candidate for Congress. And he got 24,000 votes, just short of what he needed. But that was because there was what? There was betrayal. See, the betrayal started early on. See, when we had the community choice team in 1970 with Ken Gibson and Sharp James and Dennis Westbrook and others, they weren't just endorsed by the convention, they ran on a platform. So if we run in any candidates, any progressive candidates, any radical candidates, any Pan-African socialist candidates, they can't just run on their name and their good looks. They got to run on an agenda, on a platform that's put together by the people. So Hart lost, and we had several other elections. But then in 1984, Jesse Jackson ran for president. And see what happened, you know, initially, people talk about neocolonialism, which is a good metaphor for what's happening here on the domestic side inside the United States. But they wanted to keep the Jackson camp, the people in power wanted to keep the Jackson campaign to themselves. So in 1984, there was the official Jesse Jackson campaign. We couldn't be in the official Jesse Jackson campaign, but that didn't stop us. We formed our own Friends of Jesse Jackson campaign. So see, you got to understand the dialectic of what was going on at that time. Yes, Jesse was running, and there may have been certain personal motives he had. There may have been other motives other people in power had, but it was exciting our people at the grassroots level. Now, we could have stood on the sideline and said, no, we're not going to have anything to do with that. But we said, no, we're going to jump right in it. So we formed Friends of Jesse Jackson, and we did voter registration, and we did our own events, and through that, we built up our political organization. I would dare say the People's Organization for Progress exists today because of some of the work that was done at that time. And the Jackson campaign caused a lot of people to register to vote. And what did that do? Well, one of the local struggles we had after that was whether the Newark Board of Education was going to be appointed by the mayor or whether it was going to be elected by the people. We had a referendum with a coalition called PUBS, People United for Better Schools. And PUBS successfully changed the Board of Education from appointed Board of Education to elected Board of Education. But one of the reasons PUBS won that election was because of the new voters, the grassroots people who had been brought into the process as a result of the 1984 campaign. And then also one of the byproducts of that was the mayoral election of 1986. Ken Gibson had served four terms, but the people were tired. And they said they needed what? They needed a sharp change. And one of the reasons that Sharp James was able to win in 1986, I believe, this is one man's opinion, was because of the new voters that were brought in as a result of the organizing that was done at the local level around the Jackson campaign in 1984. In addition, Jesse ran again in 1988. What happened? Was it like 84? No. Our forces had become so strong that the people in power couldn't ignore us anymore. So they said, all right, we will sit down with you guys, and instead of having two campaigns, we'll have one campaign. Sharp James was a co-chair of the Jackson campaign in 88. I was a co-chair of the Jackson campaign in the area of 1988. And what happened? Did Jesse win? No, Jesse didn't win. But what happened at the local level? Donald Payne got elected. And he got elected because of the new voters that were brought into the process. People talk about the Million Man March of 1995. One of the things that's often forgotten about the Million Man March of 1995 was the fact that literally hundreds of thousands of black people were registered to vote. In fact, it was so deep that there was an article in the Wall Street Journal that said the only demographic group to increase absolutely and relatively in number of voters were African Americans. And they cited the Million Man March as a large part of that. So what as a result of all those, well, see, what I'm trying to get to is the mechanics of how do we seize power. Because make no mistake about it, if you want to participate in the electoral process, it's about seizing power. Nobody gonna give you a damn thing. You want it, you gotta take it. It's about being strong enough to take what you want. And it's really a measurement of real strength in terms of getting somebody in office. And this is something that we have to have a serious discussion about. Do we want to participate just to raise issues? Or do we want to participate to actually get people elected? Because there's a difference between the two. You can run a campaign in such a way to raise issues, but you're not gonna win the election. Do you wanna win, or do you wanna just raise issues? This is a discussion that we have to have. And it's particularly relevant to the whole question of third parties. Because remember, we talk about the Freedom Democratic Party, but remember, the Freedom Democratic Party ran within the Democratic Party structure. It was akin to how the Tea Party is operating within the structure of the Republican Party. It was an independent caucus. Now, I've run for office independently. I ran in 1974 for the city council. I ran in 1987 for the state assembly. And I ran as an independent, not a Democratic primary. I ran in a general election. And you and I know, when you look at the numbers, in 1 year, in one election in New Jersey, you put all the independent candidates together, they didn't have more than 2% of the vote. You got to get, and this is something that we have to deal with. And I know people don't want to hear this. I know people don't want to hear this. But the question is, are we serious about taking power? And what are we willing to change to take that power? These are hard questions. You know, you say you want to be independent, but what if the game is so rigged that third party candidates can't win? You may have to run as like Charles Barron did, as an independent Democrat in the Democratic primary. Now, that's a hard pill for some people in this office to swallow. But these are some of the realities that must be confronted. We can't make believe they don't exist. And as much as we are dismayed and disappointed about Obama, our constituency is going to run over us to get to the polls to vote for him on election day. Now, we could stand on the sidelines and make believe that this is not a reality, or we could try to use some of that energy. Why not engage in voter registration so after the Obama campaign is over, we can use those people that we registered in this period to in fact get some of the people we want to get in office? I know it's a hard pill for you to swallow, and I know some of y'all are gonna talk about me, but I don't care. I'm not running for office. I ain't running. I don't care whether you talk about me or not. The other thing is, we gotta be willing to fund the campaign. You wanna put somebody in office? We couldn't get up $1,500 in here today. You wanna put somebody in office? You got to come up with the money. Because it's more of a money game today than it ever was. I mean, we talk this thing about freedom ain't free, but when it's time to collect the money, what's the practice? What's the practice? We gotta be able to come up with candidates, and when we put people in office, we got to keep them accountable. They have to be accountable to us. And I'm gonna tell you a secret. Keeping them accountable is more than just having a critique. You must have a critique because people must know the truth. But you also must have a structure, an organization, a political party, call it whatever you want, but you must have some type of machine that lets them know if they don't carry out the agenda that we sent them in there for, that we will take them out of there as fast as we put them in. Politics is a hard business. And if you approach it from the point of view of sentimentality, if you approach it from the point of view of not really understanding what you're dealing with, you can't win in that game. And I say, if we are to make the radical transformation of this country, because I'm gonna tell you something, I support people running for office. I support Rasbrook. The other thing is, we gotta learn how to deal with failure. Just because a candidate loses the election the first time should not stop that person from getting back in there and getting back in there and getting back in there until they win. See, what happens is our candidates lose and then we quit. We throw our hands up. We can't win. But you got to look at young Ross Baraka. He had to run three times. He had to run as mayor, he had to run at large, and then he ran as ward, and then he won. We got to be willing to deal with the question of defeat and look at it as trying to incrementally increase our power. The future of our people depends on this. The truth of the matter is that black people are in worse shape today than we were in 68 when Dr. King was assassinated. We are in worse shape today. And it'll grow even worse if we don't turn this situation around. We must be willing to build up our forces such that we can really contend for power. It's a hard thing to call a meeting and 100 people show up. We're not gonna change the system with 100 people. We could start with 100. We could start with 12. Jesus started with 12. But it took about 600 years for them to become a power. I ain't got 600 years. I don't want this change to be 600 years from now. I want it to be in my lifetime. I want it to be in your lifetime. I want it to be in our children's lifetime. I want to see universal health care a reality in my lifetime. I want to see reparations a reality in my lifetime. But all of these things we want will just remain on paper until we get to the point where we can call a demonstration, not the nationally recognized leaders, but Omalia Chattel and Charles Brown. We sit down, we call a demonstration. We can bring out 25, 50,000 people out in the streets to the polls, and then those people are willing to put up whatever dollars are necessary for our victory. When we get to that point, then liberation will become a reality. Power to the people.
On this panel, another round of applause. I think it was an excellent job that they did. And at this point, what we want to do is to open it up for resolutions. So if anybody have resolutions, I would like for you to line up at the mic, wherever it is it over there? And we put forth some resolution. I'm going to start with Chimarenga. I know that there's some resolutions that from the panel itself.
Uhuru. So I'm going to see if I can read my own handwriting. It's not that good, but I wanted to, with the permission of the Black is Back Conference, put this resolution on the floor for discussion. And please feel free to add or and I think that this discussion is going to be really important for putting policy in place for the steering committee to vote on and move us forward. So this is the resolution that I propose coming from the Challenging the Bourgeois Election Electoral Monopoly Workshop. The workshop participants recognize and have unity with the report to the BIB International Conference, which states in part, elections within the capitalist colonialist system only serve as a nonviolent contest between different sectors of the ruling class for control of the state. Number two, let us use the electoral process right now as one form of struggle, but let us at the same time recognize that it is only one form of struggle and that our future depends on our willingness to build a real capacity to utilize every form of struggle in our quest for our liberation. Three, we must affirmatively declared that we will use all necessary means to wrench our freedom and future out of the grasp of a dying imperialist system. Based on this understanding, the BIB resolves to identify, groom, and run progressive candidates on a local and national level whose platforms are consistent with the goals of the BIB. In order to implement this resolution, the BIB further resolves to create an electoral politics working group resolved at the BIB International Conference Saturday, August 18th, 2012. Uh-huh.
Oh, he's a recorder. That's one of the recorders of the resolution, so he probably is trying to get some clarity. I want to ask if there's anybody, any other resolution on the floor? Okay. A resolution? We're going to be asking questions. When did we say we're going to do it? At the plenary?
Excuse me, I wanted a question about the resolution.
Okay. This resolution is coming from the floor, and then the Black is Black coalition. It's an organization of coalition. It's a coalition of organizations, and they will vote on the resolution on tomorrow.
Okay.
So any resolution could come through. It's not decided on yet. Okay. The coalition will tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. Yes.
I would like to make a resolution during this conference that we consider and discuss the fact of building a real third party. And as Larry Ham said, that we use our struggles in our local areas, and I think Jim Moringa said that too about local politics, that we build that and build an honest, straight ahead third party. Because as you said, it takes a collective. It's gonna take all the Black and working class people in this country to overturn this system. Mm-hmm. And so I think the third party always comes up after the presidential election. We need to start fighting for a third party right now, so when the next election come around, we can have a real Black person or a real, I don't care what color they are, as long as they represent the entire United States of America, particularly the working class and poor people in this country. And I think we seriously need to have that discussion if we really want to overthrow capitalism. Uh-huh. So did you get the recorders?
Yeah.
City Council, going after the City Council seats. And I think that is a really good strategy that maybe we can employ, and that's what I want to propose for consideration on the steering committee.
You want to put that forward as your resolution?
Yes.
Okay. Did you get that?
Maybe Charles can write it down more clear in terms of what he meant, because when he said it, it was clear.
Okay.
Yes. You.
Yes.
Now, since this is an election year,
is why don't you get in line there and you can pose it. There's a brother that's standing. Okay.
I'm just seeking a point of clarity on the resolution. Since this is an election year, a national election year, November, the obvious question and the passage of this resolution is going to be, what is the position of the Black is Back Coalition on the re-election of President Obama. Am I assuming too much here? Is that implicit in the resolution? Again, I'm just seeking clarity.
I think, are you talking about the one that was put forward by the sister here? The resolution you're talking about? Are you talking about all the resolutions collectively or what?
No, I'm talking about the main resolution that was put forward.
Oh, the main one that was put forward by Chimarenga.
Yeah.
All right.
I think our position is the one that we talked about in the discussion of the report, and that's that we were not, people have to make a decision based on what they understand. I was not trying to imply either way or the other. That resolution was about a practical way to move our organization forward in terms of trying to get involved in electoral politics.
Does that answer your question? No? Well, I think what was said, and I don't know if there's anything more that could be said, that this is just, these again, just resolution that's gonna be taken to the BIB body to make a determination on, you know, of all the different organizations included in the BIB, that they will make a, you know, a decision on that. And if there's a resolution that you wanna put forward saying that a decision should be made in time for the election, that might be something that you want to consider, then I think it could come in resolution form. But everything here is just basically a collection of resolutions that's going to be taken to that body that can vote on it. We can't vote on it, those of us not involved in it. Okay, well maybe I'm not understanding. Is anybody understanding, from the BIB understands the problem that she's raising? Wait a minute. I'm not understanding this.
Earlier on in the position that I was asking the coalition to consider and for this body to entertain was the fact that when we talk about Barack Hussein Obama, if we just make this revolve around Barack Hussein Obama, and we get basically a really subjective response from everybody who, for whatever reason, supports Obama. We feel like it's been a weakness of our whole movement and of this period. And we haven't had a real discussion around the question of electoral politics, what role it plays in our communities or in the world, in the capitalist system at all. So the discussion about Obama, we was hoping would happen within the context of a discussion around electoral politics, its possibilities, limitations, how we should approach that as a community, so that it's not around Obama as such. People have referenced Obama in this discussion, but we weren't trying to have a referendum here on Obama are asking the coalition to make a decision about Obama. So I don't know if that responds to what you were reading.
Yeah, it's okay. A little bit better because when you talked about elections, Obama aside, the resolution comes out of this convention, then the obvious thought and question and concern for just the general audience is what is the position or what is the context for this organization position on this November election. So that was my point. Because it's a natural one. It's just natural. People will just ask that because it's an election.
Well, here's where we are confronted with. If I may just respond to what Sister Nellie is raising, and I want to treat it, you know, like as a point of clarification, is that, again, we say the coalition is an organization of organizations. And different people came into the coalition, different organizations, for different reasons. Some were Obama supporters, like Curtis Gatewood, who was the second vice, you know, president of the North Carolina, you know, NAACP. He was Obama supporter. Queen Mother Dorothy Lewis, when she first came in, Obama supporter. But they united with the coalition that held the first national demonstration against the Obama regime, not based on whether or not they supported Obama, but based on the policies that he was articulating, stood for, you know, like, et cetera. And I thought that was quite appropriate. And what we're trying to do now is have a discussion. You see, just from listening to this, I think everybody
up here should be on this, on the Black is Back coalition, and should be playing critical roles in this coalition. But you can see, if you can hear, you heard nuances, differences in these folk, you know, who were involved in this discussion. So how do we build a coalition around principles of unity that are broad enough to allow for the full participation of all the anti-imperialist forces standing for self-determination while not so sharp as to push people out? You know, that's the thing that we're looking for. And we're also saying that the coalition, one of the principles of unity, is that we recognize and respect the ideological differences that exist inside the organization. But we do have certain principles of unity. And Obama violates some of those principles in terms of his, what he does, et cetera. So that's why we can have a demonstration at the White House, and that's why we can criticize and will criticize Obama, his cousin, and his cat. You know, based on these principles that all of us say, you know, like we stand for. And that's within the context of a coalition that is united around those principles, but has not united, as far as I know, around whether or not people should vote for or not vote for Obama. We think we put out enough information for people to make their own determinations. And I really think it's important for us to take this discussion out of the subjective place and look at the question of elections. Historically, scientifically, what roles do elections play in society anyway? With the election of a Negro, for example, change the character of a capitalist state? Will a state change because he's elected? And if not, can we surrender all the democratic space that has been won in the capitalist thing by saying we won't participate in an election? I mean, these are some of the questions that we are entertaining. And I appreciate, you know, because listening, I even learn from everybody that's up here, because I hear nuanced differences, you know, in the crew. And so I'm not, you know, dogmatic around the question myself. You know, I think that's the best I can do in terms of, you know, I think responding to the question that you just raised. But I know, comrade sister Aisha and Gaida, I am not, you know, I've challenged the discipline of this meeting already with this long-winded presentation. I know we're working with a time factor, and so, as the best of us say, I'm self-critical. And I just pass it off.
How's that? I just got the 1 minute sign from the brother.
Good evening, everyone. First, I'm glad to be here. I learned a lot here that's going to benefit me as I go through the struggle. I don't know how to frame this resolution, but just as previous minutes was mentioned, principles of unity. We all also got to look at the efforts to divide us. And I've been involved in quite a number of groups within here in the city of Newark. And there's differences amongst the groups. And this is a good step in reconciliation of those groups. But I think a session there really needs to be spent on the different organizations, turf battles, egos, and how we can ameliorate those differences so we can unify on the goals and principles to reach our goals. But I see that's an undercurrent in all of our movements, whatever domain we're pursuing, like I'm involved in the school board issues here in Newark. And I see amongst the different groups, people are worried about their benefactors or foundations, if they're gonna take their money away from them. They're worried about someone on their turf. But we need to look at those differences and how we can reconcile and hold each other accountable to fight those jealousies. Because it's there. If we don't look at that, that's going to hurt.
Yes.
Quickly, I know we are in camp.
Just a second. One second, please. He's recording and he needs to get some clarity.
Oh, man. Trying to overcome the differences that have struck unity among and between black activists?
Yes. Yeah, we got to constructively go after that cause. It's the undercurrent in all of our unification.
Okay.
Yes,
we have to make it a resolution. All right, K-Fan. We're going to have to cut it off.
You know, very quickly, regardless of whatever our differences on all these questions of Obama or electoral politics, I think we need to put forth a resolution to fight this widespread move across the country of voter suppression.
That's what?
Almost 10% of the electorate in this country, most of them black, may not be able to vote. From Florida to Ohio and to Pennsylvania alone, almost 750,000 to 1 million people might not be able to vote. So I think that's an important resolution.
Let me say good evening, all. My name is Senator, and I got here late, unfortunately, and I apologize for that. I'm very thankful for this convening this today. Mike, I heard something very interesting on WBAI, George Galloway. I don't know if anybody listens to him. And he was talking about the choices that we have to make. We got two cheeks on the same horse. And he said that he would recommend that, that's his opinion, that we should support Obama. He said, because if you knew the history of the Mormon church, you know, where Romney is from, with Israel, he said, you would think twice. He said, yes, Obama has been terrible, but he feels after this election that he said he wants to come together and he would try to do what he can from in overseas, because, you know, he's in the House of Parliament, because he's just discussing what happens in the United States also affects what happens in Europe. And I thought it was a good critique. And then I heard another show where people were calling and said they weren't going to vote, and they thought that was in our best interest, though. My position, well, I probably will vote for Obama, but of course, after this, I'm looking to, you know, let's at least get some real change. Thank you.
Yes. All right, thanks, yeah. Those who are interested, I think you should get a copy of the Black is Back book, and in it, Glen Ford, he does a presentation on the electoral process. And I think that what he's talking about here is, what he's talking about is whether Obama or any other president can inherit a war, a policy, or is it just an extension of the imperialist system? So the book is worth getting. This is Black is Back on the last day.
All right, Uhuru. I want to thank everybody for participating in this topic, in this workshop. And I also want to remind you that the Black is Back, there's information on the table. People should get information, look at it, and make some decisions about everything that you've heard here and how best you can participate in the Black is Back organization. Thanks a lot. Uhuru.
I want to thank this dynamic panel, and I appreciate everything that was discussed here.
Ooh, another round of applause.